In 1861, at the start of the Civil War, the fledgling Pacific Railroad, that only arrived 8 years earlier, dominated life in the small rural town of Pacific, Missouri, located on the Franklin and St. Louis County lines. It was the railroad that brought the Civil War to Pacific. The railroad brought soldiers, trainload after trainload of soldiers, to train here, to recover from wounds in military hospitals here, to move to another front, to guard the precious railroad property, and finally, on October 1st, 1864, to fight in the Battle of Pacific. Local family members held on to stories told by grandparents, and as the sesquicentennial of the war approached, they gathered in the high school auditorium to retell their stories.
If I were to ask you, what do you think was the leading cause of the Civil War? Almost resoundingly, you would say the slavery issue. And that's right. The slavery issue was a very important ingredient going into the Civil War. But there were other things that played a part in this too. Our nation at this time was sort of like a giant cauldron. And it was just boiling over, and there were all of these issues that were in this cauldron. And one of the main issues that was in there was the economic and social differences between the North and the South at this period of time. The South was an agricultural area. It was based on a plantation style of life, and this was supported by the slaves. The North was heavily manufacturing. And it was supported by all of the immigrants that were coming into the United States at that time. So you can see the major differences between those two regions in the United States. And when Abraham Lincoln was elected, the Southern states said, that's it. We need to secede from the Union. And on April 12, 1861, they fired on Fort Sumter, and the Civil War was off. Nancy Totter is going to tell you what's going on in the state of Missouri at this time.
So the governor decides that he's going to set up camp and he's going to call out a militia, and he does that. And he sets up the camp. If you wanted to visit it today, it's down on the St. Louis University campus is where he set up a camp. Now we have hostilities between the two sides because we have the governor who's supporting the South. And before the year is out, we're going to get another governor who's going to support the North, and he's going to be just put in that position. Okay, so let's follow the path of our governor and what he's going to do. So he sets up this camp with an intention of wanting to get the supplies out of the arsenal. Well, he's going to be opposed by Nathaniel Lyon. What happens is Nathaniel Lyon marches on Camp Jackson. Some 300 men are lined up and march through the streets of St. Louis. There's going to be a lot of complaints by people, bystanders, people starting to throw things, and shots are going to be fired, and some 20 to 30 people are going to lose their lives. This is the first conflict in the state of Missouri. So Virginia is going to be the number one battlefield, the state with the most battles, and then we're going to get Tennessee, but actually Missouri is the third state. What happens is then our governor convenes a convention in Neosho and sets up a southern government, and we're accepted by the Confederacy. And then Nathaniel Lyon appoints Hamilton Gamble, so we actually have another governor. So we have two governors, two armies in the state, very confusing. We end up with over 110,000 people in Missouri serving for the North. Then there was something like 40,000 for the South. I wanted to finish with just mentioning Belle Fountain Cemetery and Calvary Cemetery in St. Louis, because they're very fascinating places. And I once read in a book, out of all the cemeteries in the United States, it has the highest ranking soldiers from the Civil War from both sides buried side by side. And to me, I think that really states what Missouri was about. You'll find General Buell there, who was a Union general in Tennessee. And you'll find Sterling Price, a very important Confederate general.
Pacific was originally laid out in 1851, and it was known as the town of Franklin. In the summer of 1851, They started the construction of the Pacific Railroad from St. Louis out to Pacific, Missouri. This was going to be very important because this is going to put our little community here on the map. So in 1853, 2 years later, the railroad arrived in Franklin, Missouri, because that's what we were known as. It was Franklin at that time. Well, the train rolled into Pacific, and they were just so happy to have it here that several years later, they called a meeting of the town board, and they had them all come together, and they talked about the possibility at the schoolhouse there, the possibility of changing the name of our town, Franklin, to Pacific, Missouri, to more closely affiliate it with the railroad. And the name of Franklin was officially changed to Pacific, Missouri, and it was incorporated to tie us in a little bit closer with that railroad. Well, that railroad that's going to put us on the map is also going to make us extremely important to the military, not only to the Union, but to the Confederacy also. And so now, once again, this is how you're seeing this pot begin to boil in Pacific, Missouri. John C. Fremont, the great pathfinder, had pinpointed this spot where the Pacific Railroad would extend a line southwest towards Santa Fe. There were only four railroads west of the Mississippi River at the start of the war, and Pacific set at the junction of two of these railroads, the Pacific and the Southwest branch that we came to know as Frisco. Two sets of early settlers came to Pacific, Missouri. There were the slaveholders from Virginia and Germans from the Northeast who hated slavery. This pretty well mirrored the rest of Missouri. As talk of the war heated up in the early months of 1861, they began to pick their sides. So we are a mirror of the United States. We were a border state. One group of patriots wanted Missouri to stay out of the war altogether. When Governor Claiborne Jackson called for volunteers in February of 1861 to protect the state from invaders, the Music family in Catawissa, Revolutionary War heroes, and true patriots signed up. A great-grandson, and Bobby said I could either call him Comer or Cummer, we always knew him as Cummers, kept the family records.
Well, I've had the enjoyment of my relatives being on both sides of the war. My relatives was, two of them was in the Home Guard that saved of Vietnam. If you weren't in the Home Guard or enrolled in the military, you were subject to the draft. And if you was drafted, you got put in the front line. So they went and joined up with a company in Bitmer, as the closest one they could find, where their other cousin, he got drafted and he went to Jefferson Barracks, and he'd never been out of Catawissa before, and he got down there and he got some disease out of the city, and he died there. So he didn't make it very far.
Well, as was mentioned, Missouri was claimed by both the Union and the Confederacy, had two competing state governments, sent representatives to both the United States Congress and the Confederate Congress, and it had a star representing them, both Missouri, on both the Confederate flag and on the Union flag. As soon as they fired on Fort Sumter, Lincoln called for 75,000 troops to enlist for 90 days. And the response was overwhelming. He got his men, no problems at all. Now, between 1861 to 1865, battalions, companies, and regiments of soldiers camped at this strategic point where the two railroads converged. Immediately after Fort Sumter, General Nathaniel Lyon commissioned Pacific Postmaster William Inks, remember he was the proprietor here, to form a battalion of Home Guard volunteers to guard the Pacific Railroad and its bridges. This is the Battle of Wilson Creek. Now, Wilson Creek was the first test of our railroad. and it was the first major conflict west of the Mississippi that occurred at Wilson Creek near Springfield. This is Francis Herron, and he's going to be very important in Pacific Missouri. He emerges from this battle, and he is quite a hero at this at the Battle of Wilson Creek. And he's with the 1st Iowa Regiment. He comes out of the state of Iowa, and he was promoted to lieutenant colonel of the 9th Iowa and sent to Pacific to guard the junctions of the railroads that had supplied the troops for the battle. Notice how they keep sending all these people into Pacific. Guard the railroads, guard the bridges is what it amounts to. Well, he's going to set up a camp here. And I think he may have a little bit of an ego because guess what he names his camp? Camp Herron. I would too, why not? So Herron would come to Pacific and create Camp Herron and name it for himself. And he locates it between two magnificent peaks next to the Merrimack River. We're unsure of the exact latitude and longitude of this camp, but local historian Bill McLaren has studied the lay of the land, and he believes that Herron's regiment occupied two campsites here.
When you looked at the little arrow in the slide in the circle a little while ago, what you saw was where the Silkasam manufacturing plant was. And when you stop and think, that's been the common thought for a while, was the Silkasam plant would have been where Camp Herron was. But when you stop and think, now they said there was three companies there. And that's not a very big place for three companies, because as we just learned, everything was done with horse muscle. So not only were there three companies of men there, there would also have been all the wagons and the teams and the horses and the mules to move those supplies. They would have had to have food for the horses, they would have had to been close to the water, and they would have to be close to the railroad. What, as you think of the description, what probably makes the most sense was where the old brick plant was, where the new industrial park is, right to the left of that circle, is probably where the camp was. That would have been a big enough area, and probably what they were describing as a gulch would be where Highway 00 would come down off the hills right now. And it would stand between the two bluffs. But I thought it was pretty amazing when you looked at the two descriptions that were just up there. One described it as Hell's Half Acre, and the other described it as two magnificent sand bluffs. I guess it really depends on where your attitude is when you're starting to talk about where home is and where you are. But I believe it would have been just to the left of that circle would have been where Camp Herron was. Now, they were right there at the railroad, they were right at the river, but there wasn't a bridge real close. They knew that the rebels would come from the south, and the Merrimack River Bridge would have been out at the end of Denton Road, probably a mile and a half or 2 miles from this area. It had been pretty hard to guard from there. But when you cross the Merrimack River, and that would have been called Priest Ford, where you cross the river, but right below the Merrimack River Bridge, or Railroad Bridge, I'm sorry. And right there is Winch Creek. Up on the bluff above Winch Creek is where the first Catholic church was. The church that was there during the Civil War was before the Rock Church was built, and the cemetery is still up there. And that bluff could be pretty well described the same way. It's a big rock bluff right above the Merrimack River and right above Winch Creek, and you have a wonderful view out across the Dane Bottom to the Merrimack River Frisco Bridge. If you go up on the bluff, you can, and you know where to go and where to look, there's three different places off that bluff, not either any of the three very far apart, but that you can observe the river and observe the bridge. One is all the way out on the point, right above the Winch Creek on the bluff, and you can actually, if you know where to go and where to look and use some imagination, you can still see where they were dug in and where they were camped and were guarding the railroad bridge. When I was a little boy, which was getting to be quite a while ago, my next door neighbor was Jim Phelan. His mother was Annie Phelan, and her maiden name was Daly. I was probably 4 or 5 years old and was down there, and my dad was helping Jim do something. And Mrs. Phelan was telling a story to me that she remembered from when she was a small child, they talked about coming and getting the women and the children to carry brush to burn a railroad bridge. And that would have been that railroad bridge. And it was right at the probably less than a half a mile from her house to where the spot was that they guarded, and another half a mile across to the bridge. So that would have been the second encampment. The area out there has got a lot of history to it. And Bobby Comer, who said his great-grandfather was there, actually homesteaded the farm that I live on. And we have the homestead papers to Samuel Whitworth, and they were signed by President Polk. And Samuel Whitworth is buried in a cemetery on my farm. So that was the area south of Catawissa, and I feel very certain that's where the second encampment was set up to guard the bridge.
There's good evidence that the soldiers were camped near the old St. Patrick's Cemetery on a high bluff that offered a clear view of the railroad bridge. The late Ed Phelan told a romantic story about soldiers who got to know the local families. On a trip to the old cemetery with a group of relatives, as he left, he stopped the tractor that pulled a makeshift trailer, turned, and retold the story. And here it is in his own words.
There was two brothers that were in the service, and on their days off, they'd come over and they'd help the Phelans cut wood and stuff, and they'd go to church with them. They was Catholic, and they went to church with them. They got to know pretty much everybody. So they was going to have a wedding up at Lynch's, and they invited these two boys to come to the wedding. So they went up there, and when they cut the cake, they had what they called a token in it. I don't know what it was. But anyhow, one of these soldiers got the piece of cake with the token in it. Anyhow, they came back here, and then they got moved from here down south somewhere as spies, and they got captured. So they was going to execute them. The day they were supposed to be executed, the guy come to get them, come to the guardhouse to get him, and he told him, he said, if you guys want to write a letter to your folks or something, why, I'll give you time to do that. I'll get the pencil and paper here for you. And the one guy said, yeah. He said, I want to write to my folks and send them this thing. And he reached in his pocket and he got this token. Mm-hmm. The guard looked at it, he said, where'd you get that? He said, well, I was stationed up at Catawissa, Missouri, or close to Catawissa, Missouri, the river, it's a railroad bridge, and I went to a wedding. I was invited to a wedding, and this was in the cake, and I got the piece of cake. He said, what was them people's name? He said, Lynch. He says, I was at that wedding, too.
I'll be darned.
The two guys come home. They got away from him between there and where they were supposed to execute him.
He let him go.
Yeah.
I'll be darned.
I wanted to tell you that.
Isn't
that
something?
Yeah.
And moving on, this is the Army headquarters. The Union Army set up headquarters in the Netcher Building, a two-story brick building that stood on the site of this florist shop. And this is the air riser. Some of the men at Camp Herron got malaria, and an Army hospital was organized in the air riser boarding house and store. This brick building set next to the tracks in a spot now occupied by the Pacific Station Plaza. Many local stories say that there was also an Army hospital in the old St. Louis Street mansion where the Bank of America stands today. At the outbreak of the war in the United States, the Surgeon General office consisted of only 115 surgeons before the start of the Civil War. 24 of those would resign and go with the Confederate Army. Now that's where they started. Smallpox, measles, dysentery, typhoid, diarrhea, food poisoning, malaria were all common diseases. They had terrible wounds. Morphine was one of their leading painkillers. And then the other leading painkiller was whiskey. Now, remember Colonel Heron? Remember he's got the camp here and everything? Okay. Well, back to Colonel Heron. Well, Colonel Heron started settling into the community and getting so he likes it a little bit. And so in December, he decides, he calls for a grand union ball, and he has formal invitations printed up. So now we move on, and this is Missouri, the Missouri 22nd. There were Union officers besides Heron's Ohio Regiment in Pacific that winter. Volunteers from the Missouri 22nd Infantry and the 10th Missouri Cavalry reorganized in Pacific in September 1861 and created winter quarters here in a camp north of town. 30 years later, the town threw a grand celebration when the old soldiers returned here for a reunion. And this is the article that was in the newspaper. Now take a look at this family. In December 20th, 1861, Robert Denny, a Catawissa farmer, joined the 26th Missouri Infantry. He kept a diary throughout the war and returned to be a leader in Franklin County politics. His great-great-grandson, Brian Buchanan, shared the diary with us.
My name is Brian Buchanan. As she said, I am the great-great-great-grandson of Robert B. Denny. The small picture up there in the corner was taken in Huntsville, Alabama, and apparently he had written some letters and sent them out to family members. As she said, he had enlisted here in Pacific on September 19th of 1861. It was 2 weeks after the death of his first son. He was involved in the siege of Corinth, Mississippi. After that, he was promoted to a first lieutenant. He was involved in the Battle of Iuka, Mississippi, where he was wounded. It was exactly 1 year to the date after which he had enlisted. He had been shot with a shotgun in the left thigh, and he was given a 30-day leave. Let's see here. The diary is actually very long. I was trying to pick out some bits and pieces here, but his main thing that he had written in the diary was when he had received mail or when he had sent out mail. Apparently that was a big thing to him. When he got a letter, he wrote it down in the diary. When he didn't get a letter, he would write something about not receiving any mail or anything. Apparently during Price's raid, it was in there that his wife, Melita, had to take all of their belongings and bury them in the woods so they wouldn't get captured during the raid. It did say in the diary that he had had a horse stolen. The picture of the house that they had showed was the house that he had built sometime around 1890, I believe. It was after the after he had gotten out of the war. He had used a lot of the money from the war to buy that particular property and build that house. The house still exists. That's what it looks like today. His son actually built the house on our current farm now that was copied after that house. And then Robert Denny, he ended up dying in January 24th of 1921. He was like 83 years old. So he had a pretty prominent life. He did quite a few things with his property, and part of the school in Lonedale is actually on what was his property at one time.
Now, maybe a lot of you have not seen this particular Confederate flag before. This particular flag here did act as an inspiration in designing the Confederate flag, but it has the most wonderful story attached to it, and I hope I can do this story justice to you. On November the 15th of 1861, First Lieutenant Bull of Company C in the 9th Iowa Regiment was directed to take charge of this little expedition of a detail of 15 good men for the purpose. They left camp at half past 5 o'clock in the afternoon, landing at Merrimack, and they proceed to Manchester on foot and surround the house of Squire B, who had been foremost in the secession movement of that strong secession town, and was reported to be in possession of the flag in question. But Squire B. protested, declaring that the flag was not in his possession and that he knew nothing of its whereabouts. Finally, after a thorough but fruitless search of the house, after the lieutenant had put her husband under arrest, the lady acknowledged that it was taken by a Mrs. S., who really only resided a mile and a half in the country. Her husband was sent to Merrimack, escorted by four soldiers, and the remainder started to the residence of Mrs. S. in search of that flag. The distance to the lady's residence was soon traveled, the house surrounded, and the flag demanded of Mrs. S. The lady replied to the demand that she would like to see the person who stated that she took the flag from Esquire B's, that the lieutenant could search her house, and if he could find anything that looked like a flag, he was welcome to it. Well, accordingly, a thorough search was made, but the flag was not to be found. The lady then thanked the officer, and she added that she trusted that he was satisfied. He replied that he was quite satisfied that she had the flag and that it would have been far better for her to have yielded it. But as she did not, he would arrest her and take her to headquarters in Pacific, Missouri. Two men were dispatched for a carriage in which they were going to convey her to the Merrimack, and she would then be sent to Pacific by railroad. She asked whether any indignity would have been offered to her had the flag been found in her possession. To this, the courteous lieutenant replied, "Certainly not, madam. Our objective with Esquire B was his arrest and the capture of the flag. But with you, our objective was just the flag." "Will you pledge your honor," she said, "that if I surrender the flag, I shall not be arrested, nor my family disturbed?" "You will not be arrested, nor your family disturbed." She then went to the bed that had been fruitfully searched already, took from it a quilt, and with the aid of her daughters, she proceeded to open the edges of the quilt, cut the stitches, and pulled off the top when, behold, there lay the mammoth flag next to the cotton, being carefully stitched twice. When taken out and spread, it proved to be a magnificent flag. It was over 21 feet in length, nearly 9 feet in width, and it had 15 stars to represent the prospective Southern Confederacy. You know, the first thing that popped into my mind is, how did they have the authority to go down there and take that flag away from them? Well, the answer to that is because President Lincoln had declared martial law. And with martial law, that means that the military is in control of the area and it acts as the police, as the court, and as the legislature. Charles Freeze, and this is a slide of his discharge paper. He was a Labadie farmer, and he joined the Union Army, and his great-grandson, Henry Ault, kept his discharge papers.
Charles Freese, he joined the Missouri Cavalry in 1862, and he went to Vicksburg, where he spent the majority of his time in service. And whenever the siege of Vicksburg was over, he went then with Sheridan and marched alongside Sherman somewhat toward the Atlanta in the march to the sea, which they always said, that Grandma Freese always said, that he was with Sheridan, not Sherman. Some of the conditions after Charlie Freese came home, he had health issues. And I can remember my dad and grandmother talking about that. They talked about Charlie and not being able to work as much as he used to be able to do. And they said, "Well, if you spent all them years under a tent and no house, you might be, you know, sick too." But what people don't realize that a person, they didn't stay in a motel or nothing, or hotel or nothing. They slept under the stars. And when Charles Freese, when he got out of the service, he decided he wanted to do something for himself, and so he left for several years and went out west. And we found over in his house where he lived, when a cousin of ours passed away, had a gun that he had bought and took that west. And I had some down at the Gimler Gun Club looked at it. They established age. They looked into it. It was 1865. So whenever he came home from service, you'd think after being out under the stars for all them years, maybe he'd want to sleep on the roof, but he left. And he took that gun out west. When he come back, he got married in 1869, and basically lived over on a farm over at St. Albans, and he died in 1897 at the age of 61. Fortunately, with this discharge paper, the way times are, go back to that, and I'd always known from the family where he was born, but a lot of times stories get confused and stuff, but I was so pleased when I received this from this cousin of my dad's, that it has right there on it, Glotzbach, Prussia. Also, if you'll look on this discharge paper, he was discharged in Vicksburg, Mississippi. He went back with Sheridan back to Vicksburg to get his discharge. And if you look real close on that, he was discharged May 24th, 1865. All right, now, if you can look on the writing on the right side, up and down, it's really hard to read, but you can see that, and Margaret and I have looked at it. It looks like May 29th in St. Louis, Missouri, he got his final discharge, and how he made it from Vicksburg, Mississippi in 4 days makes you wonder.
Railroad.
It just had to be. And it is the writing there. Most people can't get over the condition of this document. And you have to always remember that you had to have that on you, so you wasn't stopped for a deserter or anything. Also, I have a thing of, this is a Civil War projectile. And we went to the Civil War meeting, and these people looked at it. This is definitely from the Civil War. Was used by the Confederates and by the Union. Okay, the story from this is from Pacific, Missouri. Charles Freese, his son, was Frank Freese, which was my great uncle. And back years ago, before Uncle Frank passed away, he had my father come down to his place, and he gave him a lot of different things that I guess Uncle Frank maybe treasured, but my dad looked at as junk. And we had this around the farm for a number of years, and a number of years back then, Ron Sansol was talking about this, and I said, well, I have some cannonballs, and I have a shell that, well, my understanding, come from the Civil War. Well, lo and behold, I couldn't find it. And so I looked and looked and sort of forgot about it, and here about 6 months ago, I run across this. I showed this to several people. Some people said World War I, Spanish-American War, so I sort of little bit reluctant to show this and say this was from the Civil War if I was wrong. But I have documentation last night. This is from the Civil War, and this is from Pacific, Missouri.
Well, we're up to 1863 now. The rumors are going around that great numbers of rebels are positioning themselves in Arkansas to strike into Missouri. Large number of prisoners of war are being exchanged, and military leaders are again looking at Pacific Missouri. A battle-scarred regiment of the 23rd Infantry Volunteers were sent to Pacific, straight from the Confederate prison. Their first assignment after their release was to protect the railroad at Franklin. The picture that you're looking here is of Colonel Robinson. He was appointed the 23rd commander of the regiment when the regiment was exchanged, and he was sent to Pacific to guard the railroad and the bridges. This was a large regiment of at least five companies. The camp for this regiment was probably south of town at the junction of the Pacific Railroad and Brush Creek. John T. Hayes, a private in this regiment, wrote home from Pacific that troops were moving through Pacific every day. In January 1863, President Lincoln freed the slaves in the southern states. Now listen to what I'm saying. He's going to free them in the southern states, but not in Missouri. The news ran through the slave communities of Missouri like wildfire. Well, now, how could it be that he would free the slaves in the southern states, but he wouldn't free them in Missouri? Well, on January 1st, 1863, President Lincoln issued the final Emancipation Proclamation, where he officially freed all slaves within the states or parts of states that were in rebellion and not in Union hands. Now, remember at the very beginning, I said Lincoln was a strict constitutionalist. So according to the Constitution, he couldn't free the slaves at that time in the state of Missouri because it was not in, because of the way it's written, he officially freed all slaves within the states or parts of states that were in rebellion and not in Union hands. This left 1 million slaves in Union territory still in bondage. To hasten his freedom, one Franklin County slave ran away. When Colonel Robinson was ordered to arrest the runaway slave, he refused. He was then arrested, and he was ordered to stand for court-martial. So Colonel Robinson would not send this slave back. We don't have a record of Colonel Robinson's trial, but we know that he prevailed. After Colonel Robinson's trial, the 23rd Missouri moved south to join Herron's Ohio Regiment at the Battle of Corinth and in Iuka, Mississippi, and Atlanta. Francis Herron was left in command of the Trans-Mississippi Forces, the 22nd, the 23rd, and the 26th Missouri that had served at Pacific would take part in Sherman's Atlanta campaign. Atlanta fell in September of 1864. And now the march to the sea begins. But no one is paying attention to Arkansas. Who is down in Arkansas? Sterling is down in Arkansas, the two-time past governor of the state of Missouri, who is a Confederate. He was born into a Virginia plantation family. He is sitting down in Arkansas, and he is dying to come to Missouri. Finally, he is given his marching orders. But along with this, they have nothing any longer down in the Confederacy. They don't have artillery, they don't have mules, they don't have horses, they don't have food, nothing. He wants him to sweep the countryside as he goes. Bring me back wagons, bring me back ammunition, mules, horses. That's his assignment. When Sterling finally gets ready to go, he ends up and he's got only 12,000 men to do this with, and he's got 14 pieces of artillery. So after a month, he comes up and he's coming up the side here of Missouri. He gets as far as Pilot Knob, Well, that's fine because we've got a railroad coming out of St. Louis and we start sending all of our stuff down to meet him at Pilot Knob. He pays a terrible price at Pilot Knob. Well, at this time now, in his pocket, he has got a map of a town called Franklin. And he knows that there are two railroads that come into Franklin. So he continues on, but he becomes aware that all the telegraphs and everything are clicking and the newspapers are writing about him. And he's coming up here and he doubts seriously if he's going to be able to take that garrison in St. Louis. So he starts to swing west then. And he's going to come out here and he is going to come then into Franklin. Okay, so now he's at Catawissa. The clatter of the telegraph keys are going and the residents are informed that the rebels have moved north. And there's a fierce battle at Pilot Knob and the Confederate force moved forward. Pacific residents could see a huge fire to the south and concluded correctly that the railroad bridge over the Merrimack at Moselle had been burned. But what I liked, whenever we went into Ryan's store and he took everything, he leaves a chit. And he goes, they go through and they itemize everything that they're going to take out of Ryan's store and they leave it there so that he knows. Like they're really going to come back tomorrow and they plan on paying for everything. This is Riverboat Dad's house. And one family faced severe treatment. And according to his great-grandson, Billy Murphy, the family still bears the scars of Price's visit. And I'd like for Billy Murphy to come up and tell us what happened to your family during the Civil War.
The story I'm about to tell you was handed down to me from my grandmother. My grandmother was Riverboat Dan's daughter, Annie Leach. She was 92 years old when she died, and that was in 1943. So I was 12 years old, so I can very well remember the stories that came when her sisters would come from the West to visit her. Now we definitely know that Sterling Price was in Catawissa, because we have this here piece of wood that was signed by him, and he said if he won the war, he'd come back and pay him. We also know that he was headed to Signal Hill. Some people call that Lookout Hill. And the story that was told to me is that Sterling Price came through in the afternoon about 2:30 or 3 o'clock to Catawissa. And he was going to stay or camp at Signal Hill out there by the Rock Church. There was a plaque about 2 foot by 2 foot. Whenever I was a little boy, we used to always go up and look for it. And it had about Sterling Price at the highest point in Franklin County. Actually, it's not in Franklin County. It's in Jefferson County at about 150 feet past the line. Now, Sterling Price is not one of my heroes. Whenever Sterling Price came through Catawissa, he was, as they told you, how he was trying to get horses and anything he could salvage to be for Lee. He came to my great-grandfather's farm, which was called, my great-grandfather's name was Riverboat Dan. That's what his name was. He got that from being a card shark on the Mississippi River. So then he went out to the stables and he seen the fresh manure out in the barn. Now he asked the old lady, he said, where are your horses? She said, we don't have none. He said, you're a damn liar. He said, your barn is full of fresh manure. But Riverboat Dan had taken these here horses and went to a cave. Now, Billy McLaren and I talked about this cave. It was always relayed to me that it was on a Sharon place. But I'm not sure about that now. It could have been on another farm. And he kept the horses back there for 3 days. So Sterling Price was very mad whenever he couldn't get no horses or no cows or nothing. He was very mad. And he came back and he ordered the old lady to kill chicken. And the daughters had to go out and kill chicken for his supper and had fried chicken supper. Okay, they fixed him a fried chicken supper. Now, Signal Hill is approximately 3 miles from Catawissa. So about 5 o'clock in the evening, after they ate their supper, he took the two oldest girls, which were 17 and 18 years old, and he took them for 3 nights for his officers to, Civil War, the officers, for their enjoyment. So then he took them and kept them with him until he got to Pacific, whenever they had to battle at Pacific and turn, and he kept them until he got to Great Summit. Whenever he got to Great Summit, he turned them loose and he let them go home. Now them two girls swam the river. They got home at 9 o'clock at night, and how they swam the river, that has always been one of the mysterious things to me, because back in them days, the women had them long dresses and them petticoats and all that stuff. How would you swim a river with all them clothes on? But anyway, the girls made it back. Now, then after the war was over, none of the boys in the area would have anything to do with them two girls, because they had slept for 3 nights with Confederate soldiers. So therefore, they were just outcast. My other relation, which was, he was in the Union Army, and he came from Lancaster, Pennsylvania, and he fought in a battle at Pacific, and later became the first constable of Pacific. Thank you.
In the early morning hours of October 1st, a rebel force of infantry and cavalry crossed the Merrimack River. They burned the railroad bridge behind them, and they started north on the present-day Denton Road. Cannonballs would later be recovered in the old Jeffries plantation south of town. When the troops reached St. Louis Street, a melee occurred. They looted stores and set fire to about 16 buildings belonging to the railroad, including the depot, storehouses, repair shops, and the roundhouse. They even burned the water tanks. Union troops arriving from the east got off the train at Dozier Crossing, and they immediately faced cannon fire. As they approached the village, they could see a line of cannons on the slope from the crest of Prospect Hill, present-day Sand Mountain, all the way to the farm south of town. One local Boy Scout, Zach Myers, researched those cannons. And for an Eagle Scout project, he bought a replica of the cannon to occupy the hilltop. Zach, would you step up, please?
When I first started looking into cannon manufacturers that could make a good-looking replica for Pacific, one of the factors to consider was the type of cannons that were used in the area. Because of the hilly terrain in Missouri, the cannons used here had to be lighter weight compared to the larger paired cannons, as some of you may know, or the Napoleon cannons used to the east. I found out that the 12-pound was just as likely to have been used here because they were used at Wilson's Creek Battle Site in Springfield, Missouri, as well as Pilot Knob, where Sterling Price's men were before they advanced here to Franklin or Pacific. So that's the one I ended up selecting. Our field howitzer is made by Steam Cannons in Ashland, Kentucky. Its barrel is 58 inches long and would have been made of bronze. It was designed to throw large projectiles at high trajectories. The barrel rides on a number one field carriage with a wheel height of 57 inches. The barrel and the carriage weighed just over 1,500 pounds combined and measured just under 12 feet overall length. Towards the end of the war, nearly all 12-pounder howitzers on the Union side had been replaced by much larger 12-pound Napoleons that had much greater range. The Confederates, having a shortage of cannons, still had them in their arsenal, making it more likely that the cannon shot from the bluffs here in Pacific was Confederate artillery. Ideally, a team of six horses towed both the howitzer and the limber. However, the Confederates often used only four horses because that's all they had. The limber included a chest with a total of 39 rounds of cannonballs, The total weight of the howitzer and the limber was 3,214 pounds. A good crew could load and fire two rounds every minute. A howitzer with just 1 pound of powder could propel the 12-pound shell with an elevation of 5 degrees to a maximum range of 1,072 yards. So that would be like aiming our cannon on top of the hill to the east. And if you know where the Third Rail restaurant is, it was in range. So, or if you aimed it to the south, you could hit where Graphics Packaging is, or just south of Pacific Lumber. Or if you went to the west, Hardee's and Motomart we could hit it. this last slide is another actual Civil War photo of a 12-pound howitzer. This one was obviously on the side of the Union forces. I had people from both sides that helped me on this project. I got to hear some of the strong feelings that people still have about their beliefs on the Civil War. It's kind of strange that 150 years later, this war still divides some of us that choose to focus on our differences. The plaque beneath the cannon that we've got bears the following quote: "For all those who serve and sacrifice defending the cause of freedom, I hope that we will always continue to honor those who have fought and died defending our right to be free, free to believe and live the way we choose to, and to recognize our differences and accept them as long as they aren't infringing on someone else's rights. But most importantly, to come together, to work together, to accomplish great things for this community to enjoy and to benefit from. And I'm very proud to have played a part in tonight's program. Thank you for having me."
Downtown Pacific was in flames. Union forces pushed the rebels back, finally facing a formation on present-day St. Louis Street in front of the Bank of Pacific. After a four-hour battle, the rebel forces were routed, leaving the town but taking some prisoners with them. Christian Raymer was guarding the railroad bridge at the time. He recalled that the rebels broke into a store and stole a bolt of goods. As they were being chased, they strung the goods all the way to Gray Summit. They took John Davy Miley and Uncle Peter Morrison along to Gray Summit, stole their shoes, and they had to walk home barefooted. This is the Blue Goose. And 40 years later, when Fred Miley bought the old mansion known as the Blue Goose and remodeled it for his family, he pulled two Civil War cannonballs from the floor of the upstairs landing. 100 years after the war, when the old mansion was finally torn down, Dale Huffman, a member of the demolition team, recovered a board with a Civil War shell still embedded. Dale?
Oh, I guess it was about 65, 70 years ago that I spent one summer in that house. And then several years later, my uncle, my dad, and we tore the old building down. We was part of the people that tore it down. And anyway, my dad found an old diary, and it had some letters from the soldiers. It may have been a hospital then, I'm not sure. Later on, I think it was about 5 years ago, I was needing some lumber, and we had it stored that long from that old building. And I was in some of the weather boarding. I thought I'd seen a nail in it. I was going to pull it out. And it was a bullet in there. It was in like a piece of weather boarding. It was about 14 feet long. And it was the outside weather boarding. And that's just about it. So the history that I have about this part.
This is old Pap, General Sterling. There's been some speculation that Price did not accompany his troops to Pacific, but we have several recording sites of him And Uncle Peter Morrison remembered him. And if you remember, Billy Murphy was saying that his family definitely remembered him coming through. Local historian and history writer Sue Reed wrote in her book on the Jeffries family about a barbecue that the family held for the general in Gray Summit.
But when I was working in 1975 and interviewing elderly people, say in their 90s at Gray Summit, where they say the incident really did happen. And they said that Price came through with his men, and what the Southerners up at Gray Summit did is that they welcomed him with open arms and they had a party. Well, in a way, I think they really did have the barbecue, but I think that they weren't quite as party animals as you would think. What I think really happened is that when Price came through, now you have to take a look at Price's army. They're a ragtaggle bunch, and some of them don't have shoes, and they don't have the supplies that they need. And I think the Gray Summit people would have been just as afraid of old Price as the people were at Pacific. But still, they welcomed him. And I can see this happening. I can hear word coming that Price is coming. Price is coming. Well, Price is coming. And what is he going to do to us? Well, in Price's army, there were this ragtaggle bunch. Now, some of them were actually first cousins of some of the people in Gray Summit. Now, that makes an interesting situation right there. Well, as I said, I really believe the barbecue was held for the people. And I mean, by the people for Price. And what I think happened was the men got together and they said, let's get our guns, let's get our dogs, let's get our horses, let's get all this together and we'll go up and we'll visit Colonel Cruz. And they said, well, we'll consult him and maybe we'll set up a barricade on the other side of town and we'll hold them off. I think in the background over here, you sort of hear a little voice of reason. It's probably one of those little old Southern women. You can see her in her black dress and maybe her purple hat or whatever. And she's, now wait a minute, boys, she said. Just think about this for a minute. Think about it. Look how big Price's army is. I don't think you can beat him. I don't think you have any business at all coming up against him. She says, I think what we ought to do is show him Southern hospitality. And I really think that's sort of what they did. I think she told them, she said, now, you keep your guns handy, that's fine, we may need them. But you tie up those dogs, and you hide those horses, along maybe with our Jersey cows or whatever we have, hide them up in the hills, and we'll welcome Price with open arms. And you take what hogs we have, you hide half of them, the other half, while you barbecue, you make pulled pork, you dig pits, and you put the pork in there and you roast it till it's just right, where it's right hot and very, very greasy. And that's kind of what they did. So Price is probably greeted outside of town, welcomed in. His officers and he are taken up on a hill slightly above where the old firehouse is today in Graceland. And they're welcomed up there. They're probably made very comfortable, probably given some Southern comfort, probably given them the best of food. Then the pits would be down below, closer to the firehouse, and the men would be settled in just below the barbecue pits. Colonel Cruz was a soldier that was captured. Well, actually, he wasn't captured. He got sick and he was arrested, would be a better word, and he is gives the notoriety of being one of our first prisoners of war for Franklin County. Now, Cruz built, after the war, he built a huge mansion in what is the Shaw Nature Center today, and you can go up to that mansion and take a tour through there, and you can find out a great deal about Colonel Cruz and the Southern people that came to our area and settled. And were involved in the war and the building of the land.
And to continue on here, this is a marker, a 1935, the Shaw-Carter Association placed a bronze marker on Route 66 at the spot where Sterling Price's troops were turned back on the Franklin Road, which is the present day Osage. This was the last Confederate, the forward push of Price's raid stopped at Pacific, and this was the last major Confederate effort of the Civil War. 5 months later, on April 9th, 1865, the war ended at Appomattox, Virginia. As a result of this war, 620,000 men died in the Civil War. 27,000 of those were Missourians.
Pacific quickly recovered from the Civil War, and it was the railroad, with its needs for new stations, new roads, and new bridges, that brought a prosperity to the town that would last for another 60 years.